Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this live broadcast here on www.buso.de. Obviously, not only in Germany, but internationally, and that's again why we decided to make the main conference language this afternoon English. Now, let me just say a few words before we start with the proceedings. We have received before this event a number of questions that will definitely be considered in the time frame that we have, which will be just about 2 hours. But you can still send in questions during the discussion if you decide to do so. But I would ask you to send them either in German or English, because these are the languages that I can handle. If you have questions in other languages, you can send them. But you will probably have to wait so we can get back to you in written form after this event. As you have seen from the invitation, we will spend this afternoon with Helga Seppler-Rusch. She is the president of the International Schiller Institute and also the chairwoman of the German political party Bürgerrechtsbewegung Solidarität. She is very well known recently, and that is also where you might have met her for the first time, during a speech that she gave at the Rhodes Conference of the Dialogue of Civilizations. A speech that actually did receive wide international attention because she delivered a very condensed, not just analysis of the current strategic and world situation, but a solution. And I think much more importantly, she addressed the question of how to even think about such a solution, because that's often where the problem lies. She is also the principal author and organizer of a development plan that we have presented in many of the countries of Europe, a plan known as the Plan for an Economic Miracle in Southern Europe, the Mediterranean, and North Africa, which is, I think, characteristic of the way that we approach this current situation. Now, the aim this afternoon is to change history. And in order to do that, we have to address some very fundamental questions that are usually not addressed, because as you well know by now, in the year 2012, everybody knows that we are in probably the worst crisis of the last hundreds of years in modern history. And those who don't know, I don't know how to help them. But knowing that this crisis exists does not necessarily make you fit to address a solution. And as you have seen from the so-called Friday Project that Mr. LaRouche in the United States has undertaken in the last month, there is a lot more involved in this situation. And one indication that I'm pretty sure Helga will also address is that with the firing or the resignation of the now former head of the CIA, there is also a first indication of a world-changing situation, as Mr. LaRouche has pointed out, after the US election. Now, we'll get to that. And so I would just tell you the mail address again. It's webcast@buso.de, which is webcast@buso.de for your questions. And as I said, please send them in English or in German so we can put them and address them here this afternoon. So with that introduction, I give the floor to Mrs. Helga Seppler-Rusch.
Good afternoon for people in Europe, and good morning to people on the other side of the Atlantic. Well, I'm holding this live webcast because mankind is in mortal danger. And we have right now strategically a crisis which is beyond the imagination of most people. If one considers all aspects, we have to just name the most important elements of this crisis. We have a systemic crisis of the financial system, which is about to disintegrate, at least concerning the transatlantic region. We have a military strategic crisis, which, as I will point out, means that we are very, very close, potentially, to World War III. And that is probably the underlying reason for all of this. We have a very deep cultural and moral crisis, and all of these are interacting. Now, for any thinking human being who looks at the world, it should be clear that civilization is about to crash against the wall with full speed. And we need, therefore, an urgent discussion about the paradigm shift which can completely change the way we go about things and how we approach everything. Now, the purpose of this webcast is to further elaborate an already existing dialogue among intelligent people and well-meaning people around the globe, and to suggest and realize a concrete shift which must be introduced into the strategic discussion immediately. Now, this webcast is also to demonstrate that there are very practical alternatives and to once and for all get rid of this absurd statement, which is the favorite sentence of Mrs. Merkel, who keeps saying that there is no alternative to her policies, and there is an alternative. It is very useful to remember what my husband, Mr. Lyndon LaRouche, had said last week, only 1 week ago. He said, when the whole election hysteria in the United States was still at a peak and people were thinking in terms of party politics and, you know, belonging to this club or the other club, he said, don't think about what happens on Tuesday, on November 6th. Just wait until the end of the week and then you will see how reality will assert itself. And indeed, we have right now, only 5 days after the US election date, dramatic global shifts underway, which already mean we are in a different universe than a week ago. Now, only 3 days after the election day, General Petraeus, the head of the CIA, resigned. Now, the ostensible reason is an admitted extramarital affair. There may be something to that because it is now becoming clear that the FBI was investigating Petraeus since the spring of this year, but for obvious reasons, it was decided to keep Petraeus and not have the scandal erupt before the election, which may have caused serious, serious national security problems that needs to be investigated. But much more likely is that this firing, or resignation rather, of General Petraeus has to do something with what is now coined Benghazi Gate, namely the scandal around the assassination of Ambassador Stevens and three other American employees of the embassy, beginning or actually on September 11th, that is almost, yeah, eight weeks ago. And this Benghazi Gate, the circumstances of this incident has been coined by the Republican Senator McCain as the much more serious than Watergate, because in Watergate, no blood was, you know, on the hands of the people involved. Now, this Benghazi Gate story is a very, very big affair. But, you know, the second very dramatic shift also in the last couple of days was that the Russian defense minister and joint chiefs of staff were replaced, and there is a much broader military and military-industrial reorganization. Now, immediately after the election date in the United States also, Prime Minister Cameron of Great Britain decided, backed up by Obama, to have a military escalation against the government of Assad in Syria by arming the rebels, a policy which very easily could lead to a confrontation, is already a confrontation with Russia and China, and could easily lead to the triggering of a large war. And the firing of a rocket from the side of the Syrians on the Golan Heights, supposedly in response to some grenade which have been flying for several days, you know, also shows you how what a powder keg the situation in the Middle East really is. Then, fourthly, both in the United States and in Europe, you have absolutely brutal austerity, murderous austerity, and in the aftermath of the big storm Sandy, which destroyed big important sections of New York and New Jersey, now it turns out that the ability to repair this is not existing, and that the proud city of New York in part has been reduced to a situation like Haiti, like the third world. Now the situation in Greece, Italy, Spain, Portugal, where the cuts imposed by the Troika, or better as it is now called, the Distroika, are increasing the death rate. And in general, the Eurozone and the United States financial banking system and economy are about to disintegrate, either through a chain reaction collapse or through the infamous policy of quantitative easing 3, which is a synonym for money printing, which is also done not only by Bernanke, but also by the EZB. Now, the combination of all of these things should tell anybody that we are in an absolutely explosive situation which could go out of control as we are talking here, or I'm talking and you are listening. Now, first, let's look at the situation concerning the resignation of General Petraeus. Now, this is big. This is very big, and it is a genie which is not going to go back in the bottle, because all the attempts to have cover stories and so forth will not work, because too many people have been injured or killed, for that matter. There will be many hearings in the Congress and in the Senate starting on the 13th, that is 2 days from now, and continued on the 15th in the House and the Senate. The first round of these meetings will be behind closed doors, but despite certain signs that there is a desire to do so, the likelihood that the truth about what is really going on there can be suppressed is very unlikely. Now, this is a big deal because, as I said, the FBI already started to investigate General Petraeus' email and other things in the spring. And obviously, given the fact that he had this affair with a journalist who is an American educated from West Point, but nevertheless, that he had all of this email traffic, probably means that he should have been resigned months ago, because it probably was a violation of national security. Now, everything points to the fact that President Obama did not want this scandal to erupt before the election. And obviously, there is much more to it. And you know, even if the truth will only come out if all of these congressional investigations proceed, there are certain circumstantial things which are already known. One is that it involves very important policy issues, because it is now generally recognized by a large section of the American military and the American intelligence community, as well as observers from other parts of the world, naturally, that the entire policy of fighting Al-Qaeda, fighting the war on terrorism, going for regime change, using drones, that this whole policy has completely failed. And even if you follow the internal logic of American interest, the result is a complete rubble field. That, for example, there are people in the military and in the intelligence community who recognize that this drone warfare has led to the exact opposite Namely, it has led to an increased recruitment of Al-Qaeda members. And it was General Petraeus in particular who was in charge of the so-called militarization of the CIA. And, you know, this has actually led to an increased hatred of the United States and, you know, obviously many innocent casualties. Now, this policy of drone warfare, you know, which, you know, has minimum caused 1/5 civilians death, which has contributed to or has caused at least 1/5 of these innocent civilians were children. Altogether, almost 5,000 people were killed. There are bills of impeachment being prepared right now against President Obama, and there is an because of this, because it was completely lawless, no accusation, no legal process, and there is right now an investigation in the United Nations for the same crime. And naturally, the situation is complicated by the fact that you have now Muslim Brotherhood governments or, you know, governments which are close to the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, in Tunisia, in Turkey, and potentially many other countries. Now, the whole story of Benghazi is obviously what is really at stake here. Now, the Obama administration and Obama personally and especially Susan Rice maintained up to almost 2 weeks after the terrorist attack on September 11th that this had nothing to do with Al-Qaeda, but that it was a spontaneous demonstration because of this anti-Islamic video, which you know, was already known to many authorities at the time that that was not the case. The questions which are now being asked is why on September 11, on the 11th anniversary of September 11th, when it was clear since many months and several reports had been written by Ambassador Stevens asking to reinforce security, warnings that the whole situation was pretty much out of control, why was there nothing done to beef up the security? Then why, when all the other institutions like the British Embassy, the Red Cross and others had left Benghazi because of the untenable security situation, why did the US consulate and the CIA house, which was 1.5 miles away from the consulate, why did they stay? Why was a private British security firm used, which had supposedly unarmed personnel, and why was there no response to the fact that these employees were warning that a terrorist attack was about to occur? Why was it, when it was known 20 minutes after the attack, and emails were sent to the White House, the State Department, and the Pentagon, that nothing was done to come to the help of the ambassador and the three other Americans? There was a CIA house nearby. There were special forces trained for these kinds of things, reinforcement teams in Rota, in Spain, in Sicily, in Bahrain. Why were they not deployed? If it is true, which is likely, that drones were flying over the Benghazi consulate, transmitting live video feeds in real time to the White House and other places, why was there no action? Why did President Obama the next day still have this story about these were spontaneous demonstrations? I mean, one explanation could be that he had based his entire election strategy on the fact that he killed bin Laden, that he eliminated Al-Qaeda, that he was a strong man respecting security, and he didn't want a terrorist attack to ruin that image. But it now looks that there are more things behind that. Because we, that is our colleagues in the United States from EIR, Executive Intelligence Review, we had already reports on the 12th of September, that is one day after the attack, that it was done, that the attack was done by Ansar al-Sharia, this al-Qaeda-related terrorist groups, and that they had a strong presence in Libya and in Benghazi in particular. Now, it is very likely that they were, that this whole operation has something to do with arms supplies coming from Syria, from Libya to Syria, and that this was related to the reinforcement of the terrorist part of the Syrian opposition. Now, one comment which captured the situation was remarked by President Putin, who sarcastically said, well, if you look at the people operating in Syria, you could just open the prison of Guantanamo, let these people out, arm them, and send them to Syria, because it's the same kind of people. Now, the Wall Street Journal and the Daily Telegraph all hinted that the consulate in Benghazi may have been a diplomatic cover for hidden CIA missions, and that the whole operation may have been involved in weapon deliveries to the Syrian opposition. Now, General Petraeus was supposed to testify under oath this coming Wednesday or Thursday in front of the House and Senate commissions. Now, well, he will not probably get off the need to testify because the Republican Congressman Peter King, who is the chairman of the House Home Security Commission and also a member of the House Intelligence Commission, basically said that he will have to testify a little bit later because he was absolutely at the center of events and that he has to testify more than anybody else. Now, the genie, therefore, will not go back into the bottle. This is a very, very big affair because it involves the failure of the regime change policy, which started with Bush Senior and the neocons when the Soviet Union disintegrated in 1990, which you remember at that point when the Soviet Union basically collapsed, and there would have been the possibility to have a true peace order for the 21st century. Unfortunately, at that time in the United States, in the Bush Senior administration, you had the emergence of the neocons and their new American century doctrine, which was essentially the idea, now that the main enemy was gone, to basically subdue the world under the control of an Anglo-American empire based on the special relationship between Great Britain and the United States. Now, one outgrowth of this terrible imperial policy was the Blair Doctrine. Blair gave this horrible speech in 1999 in Chicago, in which he declared that the era of the Peace of Westphalia has ended, that the UN Charter, which guarantees the national security, sovereignty of nations, has essentially ended, and that from now on there was the right to protect, as this policy was later called, to have humanitarian interventions around the globe, and under the pretext of human rights violations and similar things, to intervene against a list of villains, of rogue states, basically that, you know, led to the present chain of disasters. We should remember that Blair, the author of this policy, which is now adopted by the Obama administration, was also the author of the lies which gave us the second Gulf War. He was instrumental in writing or in getting this MI5 memorandum written, which said Saddam Hussein was linked to Al-Qaeda, which was a lie that Iraq was in the possession of weapons of mass destruction, which was a lie, that these weapons could reach in 45 minutes every city on the globe, which all turned out not to be true. This policy, not only Blair's policy, not only represents a war crime, but it has led to a complete, utter, total failure of the policy of the United States and, unfortunately, the West, at least those who participated in elements of this policy. The policy of regime change and murder, or, well, finally, you know, execution of Saddam Hussein means that this country has been bombed back into a Stone Age. You are now on the verge of a full-fledged religious war between the Sunnis and the Shiites in Iraq. Then, if you look at Afghanistan, where, you know, in light of what we now know about the true origin or the true circumstances of September 11th, the original first September 11, probably this war, which invoked Article 5 of NATO, should have never happened in the first place. And if you look at the situation in Afghanistan now, it is also an utter total failure, where the Afghani trainees, which are supposed to eventually take over security, are now turning around more and more and killing those people who are training them, which is not exactly the proof of the success of this policy. Now, the war of aggression against Libya, which was a war of aggression and not a humanitarian intervention, as Obama declared it, probably to fool people in the United States to avoid to go to Congress and get the permission from Congress to declare war, because the founding fathers of America had a very good reason to say that only Congress can declare war, and not one man, not the president, but that you need to have the agreement of the Congress, which Obama, by declaring it a humanitarian intervention, avoided, and also at that point caused Russia and China to be neutral in the UN Security Council. Now, obviously, the lesson of that was learned by Russia and China, and in the case of Syria, they are no longer neutral, but they have set a very clear veto when it came to operations against Syria. Now, when the bestial murder against Gaddafi occurred, it was clear that, you know, that is part of a whole campaign which was supposed to be extended immediately to Syria, to Iran, to Russia, and to China. Now, look at the situation in Libya today. You have a completely destroyed country, a country which may not have been a humanist haven under Gaddafi, but it was, as it was with Saddam Hussein and Iraq, and as it is now clearly seen in Syria, all of these countries had much, much, much better conditions with the so-called dictators than now. In Libya, you have now tribal warfare. You have an increased presence and control of Al-Qaeda and similar groups. And if you look now at the so-called opposition in Syria, which exists, but this opposition, you know, the real opposition, they still prefer President Assad to what is now coming in the form of Salafists and Al-Qaeda forces financed by Qatar and Saudi Arabia. Now, this all has to be investigated, and it has to include an argument which has been made by Senator Bob Graham, who was the head of the House and Senate Congressional Investigation Commission, which looked into September 11th and produced a report. However, of this report, 28 pages are still classified to the present day, despite the fact that President Obama in the 2008 election campaign had promised to declassify that, something which was demanded by the families of the victims of the tower that, you know, who wanted to know, you know, what is in these 28 pages, and Obama never declassified it. Now, at the occasion of the recent September 11th, Senator Graham wrote an article in the Huffington Post where he said these 28 pages have to be urgently declassified because they pertain to the role of Saudi Arabia. And if one knows anything of the region, then that is the crucial track to really find out what is the control, the imperial control by Saudi Arabia and the British over, on the one side, US policy, but also reaching into European policy. Now, the intent of Prime Minister Cameron and Obama, and remember that Blair is the military advisor of Obama presently, to arm the rebels and to, you know, increase the efforts to topple President Assad, or if it would ever come to the desire by the Turkish government to establish a no-fly zone in parts of Syria, if it comes to that, and we are very close to that, that could only be reinforced with military means. And then, given the fact that Turkey is a member of NATO, you would have probably instantly a conflict with Russia and China, which could very quickly lead to World War III. Now, you have to look at the picture as a whole to understand why I'm saying that we are very close to World War III. Now, there is the declared intention of Prime Minister Netanyahu from Israel to strike against the nuclear facilities in Iran. Now, does Iran have nuclear weapons? I don't think so. And this is also the opinion of the National Intelligence Estimate. This is the umbrella organization of the American Secret Services, who recently reiterated their findings from 2007 that Iran has discontinued its military program, its nuclear weapons program in 2003, and that they have not started it again. That, however, if you put yourself in the position of Iran, being surrounded by nuclear powers, Russia, China, India, Pakistan, Israel, which is said to have either 200 or 400 nuclear warheads, Iran, in the best estimate of sources, knowledgeable sources, is trying to be nuclear weapons capable as quickly as possible, but it does not pursue a nuclear weapons program. Now, that's a very important difference, but if there would be a strike against Iran, obviously, in that case, and it is also estimated that Iran would not, that the entire nuclear program could not be destroyed, and with a certain delay of maybe a year or two, Iran for sure would try to achieve nuclear weapons, cancel the NPT treaty, and then as quickly as possible develop nuclear weapons. But that is a different situation than that as if Iran would already be pursuing a nuclear weapons program. Now, if this would happen, you know, it would mean World War III. This is the understanding of every Mideast expert or strategic analyst. And the only reason why it has not happened yet is because you have the US military, the US Joint Chief of Staff, the Israeli military, Israeli intelligence services, Mossad, Shin Bet, who all are totally against this because they know it not only would lead to the destruction of Israel, but it would lead probably to World War III. People have spoken about this would lead to a 100-year destruction of the entire region. But, you know, we are on a hair trigger. Now, there is this intention by Netanyahu. He has said it himself many times. And now you have the following additional situations. You have a major maneuver involving almost 5,000 soldiers, 3,500 American soldiers, 1,000 Israeli soldiers in the maneuver called Austere Challenge 2012. Now, this is simulating an air.
Of the anti-missile defense shield, which Russia is objecting so much. Now, then this maneuver started on the 21st of October,
and it is still ongoing. Then, since a couple of days, you have a huge maneuver involving US and Japanese troops around these contested islands in the Pacific. These are 50,000 troops, and the Chinese government has already said that they regard this as a provocation just by the sheer number policy. Okay, so then you have to look at what is the position in respect to Russia and China. Now, when the old Bush administration started the policy of regime change in 1990, which was only interrupted in the 8 years of Bill Clinton, there was very clearly a situation where the East extension of NATO was regarded by Russia and China as an encirclement policy. Now, the US-NATO missile defense system, which is being built in Poland, Czechia, and Spain, has been declared completely unacceptable by the new Joint Chief of Staff of Russia, General Gerasimov, who, at a conference a couple of months ago in Moscow, basically made the point that this missile defense shield is not directed against Iran, but it would take out the second strike capability of the Russian strategic nuclear arsenal and therefore make Russia essentially defenseless and completely destroy the strategic balance. Therefore, as Gerasimov was saying at the time, could lead to the use of nuclear weapons in Europe itself. Now, if you look at all of these situations, the situation around Syria, Turkey, the fact that this conflict is already spilling over into Lebanon, into Jordan, the tension between Israel and Iran, the building of the missile defense shield, which is not, the remarks of Russia cannot be called for internal propaganda use. I mean, as some, in my view, rather irresponsible politicians are saying in the West, this is serious. Then you have these maneuvers, and you have, on top of it, a very tense situation with a drive to extend these wars being pushed right now, mainly by Blair, by Cameron. All of this means that we are on the verge of World War III. And if it comes to that, it would, in all likelihood, come to the use of thermonuclear weapons. And it is the nature of such weapons that they would be used all at once, and you could have the extinction of human civilization in about one and a half hours. Now, as I said in the beginning, this is a crisis beyond the imagination because it comes together with an escalation of the financial crisis in the transatlantic region. The United States banking system and the European banking system, but for these continuous streams of bailout packages, are completely bankrupt. If you look at what is happening in the United States in the aftermath of this Sandy storm, there are still hundreds of thousands of people in New York and New Jersey without heat, without electricity, without gasoline. There are people stuck in high-rise buildings 20-story buildings where people, you know, older people cannot easily go through pitch dark hallways down 20 stories and then go a mile to get food and water. So there are people now starting to really freak out, and they're still dying. When the storm happened, my husband, Lyndon LaRouche, immediately said, look, this will never be rebuilt because the money is not there. You would need huge sums in order to prevent this. It would have been necessary to build shields against the floods, which would have cost about maybe $6 billion. There was a proposal by a Dutch firm about 3 years ago, but for austerity reasons, it was decided not to build this. Now you probably have $16 billion or maybe $100 billion damage, but that money is not there. And the spare parts are not there. Because if you want to rebuild, for example, the New York subway, the production capabilities to do that are no longer existent. Now, if you look at just a couple of figures of the rest of the picture of the United States economy, 43 million Americans are dependent on food stamps. Now, that's not a small number. That means it's about half or more than half of the population of Germany. So just draw a line maybe at the Rhein-Main era, and either in the north or in the south, all of these people would be living on food stamps. Every seventh American is depending on that. By the end of the year, the U.S. federal debt will be $16.8 trillion. This is a sum which increased by $6 trillion during the period of the Obama administration. The per capita indebtedness of the United States is 35% higher than that of Greece, and it is higher than that of Italy, Spain, Portugal, or France. Now, if in this situation the only answer is murderous austerity policy, which is what Obama is now announcing and which is causing the American trade union movement to fight the same Obama whom they voted for only 5 days ago and have rallies all over the place, this policy of austerity is now imposed on Greece, which already has 58% of youth unemployment, Spain 55% youth unemployment, and now the Troika, or better, this Troika, demands further cuts before the next tranche of bailout money will be paid. They demand 10, 20, 30% cuts in wages and pensions. They want to shut down hospitals. They want to cut health care, and this is murdering people. Now, the EU, in its present form, and people should not, you know, blind themselves to that, is just another expression of the Blair policy. What I mean by that is, if Blair's doctrine is to end national sovereignty, to end the period of the Peace of Westphalia, then you know, with only one aim, to postpone the bankruptcy of a bankrupt financial system, that is what we see right now. They combine brutal murderous austerity with quantitative easing 3, and Draghi from the EZB says, whatever it takes to save the euro. This is leading in the short term, and I really mean short term, to a hyperinflation in the entire transatlantic region like it was in 1923. And as we know in Germany from family experience, that hyperinflation is the most brutal form of expropriation. Now, I could paint the picture more elaborated, but let's just stop here. There is a solution. It requires, however, a fundamental paradigm shift and a complete turning away of politics as usual. We need to go back to the principle of the Peace of Westphalia, the complete respect for national sovereignty. We have to completely reject the idea of humanitarian intervention and of supranational bureaucracies. Now, for Europe, this means we have to absolutely cancel the EU treaties from Maastricht till Lissabon. We have to return to national currencies, and we have to establish simultaneously a global Glass-Steagall Act. And I mean the real Glass-Steagall and not some real Glass-Steagall as Franklin D. Roosevelt imposed it, and not some watered-down versions like Vickers Commission, ring-fencing, Volcker-Rule, which leave holes for banking speculation like barn doors. And we have to have a real separation of the banks, where the state protects the commercial banks, and the investment banks have to get along without taxpayer money and without having access to the savings of the commercial banks. Now, if that means that most of these investment banks have to declare insolvency, so be it. But this circle of refinancing a small circle of speculators who become richer and richer, and a mass of population in the United States and Europe, which is plunging into third world conditions, that has to stop. And there is no legitimate reason to continue this policy for 1 minute. There is a solution, namely to go back to a credit system in the tradition of Alexander Hamilton, the first treasurer of the United States, to go to national banking and give credits for real production. Now, admittedly, this will be a little bit bumpy. It will not be without a short period of problems. But compared to hyperinflation, which is going to eat away all the savings of the population and will lead to chaos in the short term, if even Helmut Schmidt, who is a proponent of this same policy, is warning about civil war and a revolution erupting in Europe, I can only say this is what will happen in the short term, because if there is hyperinflation or an uncontrolled collapse, people will indeed, go crazy, because there is no future and no hope. If, however, one does an orderly reorganization, cancels the EU treaties Maastricht till Lissabon, goes back to a national currency control over the own currency and the own economy, and then starts to rebuild the real economy, there is no reason why the economic miracle, which Germany did in the post-war period with the help of the Marshall Plan and the credit lines from the Kreditanstalt für Wiederaufbau directed to real production, why that example cannot be replicated at any point really in the world. Now, for the United States, this means we have to have NAWAPA, the largest water management project ever undertaken in history, which is already ready to go. There were congressional feasibility studies already made a long time ago, and we have updated it to be NAWAPA 2011 or 21st century. And we need for Europe the extension of the World Land Bridge, the Mediterranean and Africa. And now we definitely need to have a complete different approach to the Near East and the Middle East. Now, the whole region, including Central Asia and the Gulf, must immediately put on a plan for real economic development. We have to have infrastructure corridors connecting to the World Land Bridge in Russia, China, and other countries. And we have to have transport corridors connecting that part of the world with Asia, with Europe. But especially, we need to have huge amounts of new fresh water. Because if you fly with a plane over this region, from the Sahel zone to the Sahara, to the Arab Peninsula, to most parts of, until Central Asia, where you also have tremendous water shortages, you have desert. Now, the ridiculous absurdity is that for every $1 earned by most people in this region, I'm not talking about the sheikhs, but I'm talking about the average population, there are $50 spent on military expenditures. Now, is that not insane? Should we not rather have an agreement from Russia, China, India, Iran, hopefully some European countries, hopefully United States, to really develop this region? Now, my institute, the Schiller Institute, is presently working on a comprehensive development plan for the entire region from Central Asia all the way Iran, Iraq, to the Gulf state, to Egypt, Syria, Israel, Palestine, all the way to Turkey, and to take that region as one entire area hanging together and plan an infrastructure development plan as you would look at Western Europe or at certain parts which are developed in the United States. And there is no reason why this region cannot be uplifted through a joint development strategy. And this way you establish a higher level of reason, which allows all these countries which are right now, or many forces in them are, you know, being murdered, being slaughtered, slaughtering each other for ethnic, religious, and other conflicts, and basically say that if they agree to work together for a higher purpose, that peace can be established in this region. Now, the Schiller Institute will shortly present this plan, and I want to invite all of the people who are listening to this webcast to contact us and collaborate on the implementation of this program. Now, we must turn this region, which right now could be called the cockpit for World War III, and which is like the Balkans Wars before World War I, a region where you have so many historic alliances and you know, conflicts which immediately start to kick into each other and, you know, go into a big war. That has to be completely changed, and you know, an economic this area has to become an economic prosperous region and be guided by the policy of peace through development. Now, as I said, if we can get the big powers, the neighbors, Russia, China, India, Iran, hopefully some Europeans, hopefully the United States, which will have a very different situation in a short period of time, I'm sure of that, then there is hope. Now, we have to, at this point where we are looking at the potential extinction of civilization, we have to change the paradigm. And we have to stop to think in terms of supposed geopolitical interest and the destructive extension of war, which is a policy of absolute evil. This policy of regime change and trying to topple government after government is evil, and it has to stop. Now, we have to change instead to the common aims of mankind. If we don't make this shift, then it will turn out, but there will be nobody to watch probably, that we will not have been more intelligent than the dinosaurs, who went extinct 65 million years ago. Now, let's look at another area where the common aims of mankind are absolutely urgent. Now, in our universe, in the different galaxies, there are billions of asteroids and comets flying in space. Many of them have not been discovered. We don't know where most of them are, but they have devastating consequences. You all have seen pictures of the moon, for example, where there were craters which were hit by such comets or asteroids. About 250 million years ago, there was an asteroid which impacted the planet and had a deadly chain reaction of events of tsunamis, volcano eruptions, of poisonous liquids which developed. And all of this led to a 98% extinction of all species. Now, 65 million years ago, another asteroid hit near the Mexican coast, which had an impact of 200,000 times the entire nuclear arsenal. And that sent shockwaves around the world and created a gigantic dust cloud, in the context of which then the dinosaurs and about 70% of all species at that time disintegrated and died out. Now, the last large impact was in 1908 in Tunguska in Siberia, where either an asteroid or a comet exploded before it touched Earth, but nevertheless had an impact larger than the eruption of the volcano in St. Helen. It was relatively small, but basically it still led to a huge crater of the size of larger, the territory of larger New York. Now, at the beginning of this year, an asteroid flew by the Earth, and it did not hit naturally, but now it turns out it's coming back. It will fly by the Earth again on the 13th of February, and only 24,000 kilometers distance. Now, that's not a very big distance if you look at the universe at large. It only has a diameter of 30 meters, and it would only create a crater, if it ever would hit on Earth, of the size of the territory of a small city. Now, in the last 60 years, there was an enormous progress in the knowledge about our and other galaxies. The theory of comets developed, we developed telescopes and probes, which we can send around in the near space. And there is a bigger, deeper understanding about the orbits, the chemical composition of these asteroids and comets. And it is right now an absolute priority to discover them in time, to discover them when there is enough warning time, and to develop the means to neutralize them, to change their direction. There are various proposals how this can be done. But, you know, all of these things are not yet tested, and obviously one has to be extremely careful about the side effects. But so far, there is no reliable method yet. Now, if you really think about that, mankind has every reason to be afraid that we eventually suffer the same fate like the dinosaurs. And even if one can say that these comets always triggered a new evolution or new qualitative level of evolution in terms of species after the reptiles were eliminated in one earlier great extinction, the dinosaurs developed. After the dinosaurs were eliminated, the mammals, warm-blooded creatures developed. But I don't think we can really be relying on that if we are extinct, some more intelligent species will develop, which the universe is probably going to produce. But I don't think that that would be acceptable. So mankind should basically, you know, develop abilities to conquer dangers from space. And long before the sun is going to have serious troubles, maybe much earlier than 2 billion years from now, we should be able to redefine the way we think about our position on the planet, and we should define the common dangers and common aims of mankind and work together, like the proposal of the SDE, Global Missile Defense Systems, which is not excluding Russia and China, but including them. We should have joint research and development concerning the danger of asteroids, comets, early warning systems for volcano eruption, for earthquakes. And these are the things we should basically engage together. Now, there is optimism. There is reason for optimism, because when the Curiosity Mars rover was landing just a little while ago, this gives us, for the very first time, the perspective to look from Mars on the future of changes, which basically, you know, we have to start focusing on. We now have an observation point on Mars, admittedly with a 14-minute delay before signals which are sent from Earth are going into effect on Mars. But we can from now on use this Mars rover and future such rovers and other instruments to map the relations in the solar system, and to study those areas where asteroids and comets are very dense, for example, the area between Mars and Venus. And we have to find out where these rocks are, what is their orbit, which of them are threatening Earth. And we have to no longer think sort of like little people on the planet Earth and look up into space, but we can think from Mars and from Earth naturally and from the Moon and soon from other places. That means we can think about the universe in a completely different way. Now, that means we can make a qualitative leap in the way we think. We can leave the domain of sense perception and the reliance on our senses as a means of cognition. We can think in terms of the universe as composed of a complexity of universal principles. And as it was in the history of science and of classical art always, whenever you introduce a new principle, a new qualitative principle, this redefines the entire set of existing known principles to that present time. Now, we are now in front of a situation where either we continue the way what we are doing right now, or we make a leap where we go to the common aims of mankind and accomplish what the great German-American rocket scientist Kraft-Ehrke called the extraterrestrial imperative. Now, he coined that notion to specify the necessary next phase in the evolution of mankind. I mean, if you think that the life on the planet developed from the oceans by aid of photosynthesis to the earth, to the ground, in the form of vegetation, then after a certain point in the evolution, human beings appeared. Human beings first lived only at the endings of rivers or coastal areas. Then, because they developed infrastructure, they could expand more and more on more and more territory, a process which is not yet completed because there are entire areas of the world which are not yet developed through infrastructure, but that the manned space travel would be the necessary next step in the evolution of man. That was Kraft-Ehrke's idea, and that the extraterrestrial imperative would also mean that people had to become rational human beings and follow natural physical scientific principles, because otherwise you cannot be in space and survive. Now, I think we are now at that point where either we can get our act together, so to speak, and stop solving conflicts by war, because it is threatening to lead to our destruction, and that we have to leave the era of infantilism, geopolitical wars, or juvenile delinquencies, and reach the adulthood of mankind. Now, there is a third aspect of this civilizational crisis which I was mentioning in the beginning, and that is the moral decadence of our Western culture, and it is the deep, deep cultural pessimism which has basically almost taken over most people. If you ask people in the street to help to implement such plans, as I was here mentioning, the normal answer you get is one cannot do anything anyway, or you know, man is bad, evil anyway, or you know, people have a deep-rooted cultural pessimism, which naturally comes from the paradigm shift of the last 40 years. Just compare the present perception of what people think with the cultural optimism which existed in the period of the Apollo program. When you would ask young children or teenagers, what do you want to become when you are grown up? And many of them would say, I want to become an astronaut, I want to become an engineer, I want to do this, do that. Now, with 58% youth unemployment in Greece, with people, you know, being young teenagers being unemployable because they have no motivation to learn, many Mittelstand firms are, you know, hiring apprentices only to lay them off after a couple of weeks because they just don't want to work and they cannot work. If you look at the youth culture, you know, which is, you know, in many cases a combination of bestial pornography, violence, and which is the result of a degeneration from generation to generation for the last 40 years and maybe longer. Well, this complete lack of empathy, of complete egoism, of almost autism of many children and teenagers, well, then you can not deny that we have a big problem. Because if the youth generation is the most feared and dangerous part of society, then you know something went deadly wrong. Now, contrary to that, if you consider for a moment the absolute enthusiasm with which the landing of Curiosity on Mars was greeted by youth around the world, who, even if they may not have known all the scientific principles involved, naturally they had a reaction, man, there is a future, there is something out there is something I have to still to discover and something I have to learn for. Now, the idea that there is a future is what is absolutely important. Because the only way man can avoid extinction is a shift in the identity of an ever larger number of people, away from immediate gratification of the senses in the here and now, the maximization of pleasure and the avoidance of pain, and a shift to the identity to be truly creative people. Now, the creativity, the passion to discover new universal principles in classical art and in natural science, and to study the laws of the universe, is only possible if you have a vision of the future. If you have a vision of man in space, a man who uses the breakthroughs making in space or in space research to solve the problems on Earth, because that's the only way how they will be solved, and use that as a guidance to shape the presence. When it is clear that mankind can only survive in the universe by progressing to higher states of scientific understanding and higher levels of energy flux density, is it then not a crime not to pursue these sciences and developments and to totally abandon the green paradigm, because the green paradigm means by definition that man will never conquer the dangers coming from space, because you know all the energy flux density rich or high energy flux density sciences and technologies which are necessary are going to be victimized by such crazy ideas like those of Mr. Schellenhuber and his crazy plan to decarbonize the world economy. Now, if you go in the direction of the green paradigm, then mankind will not survive. It may not be as quick a death as thermonuclear war, but it will be a slow death because we will put out of our arms and hands all the scientific tools which we need to guarantee our own survival. Now, just look at it in perspective. Mankind is only around for meager 7 million years. That is very, very short. Recorded written history is only 5,000 years. Space exploration began seriously less than 100 years ago. The sending of telescopes and probes only really started to be thought about 50 years ago. Now just think, if we now shift gears, say no to the green paradigm, say no to geopolitical wars, and instead focus on the common aims of mankind, focus on those science and technologies and classical art forms which are truly human, then just think how in 1,000 years from now mankind would look. Now, we will make quantitative leaps which will be much, much, much bigger and much more beautiful and exciting than the development we took from the Stone Age till now. And if you would have asked a Stone Age man, you know, how will people look in the year 2012, he probably would have looked pretty stupid. And if you ask the same question to most citizens today, how will mankind look in the universe, in the space, 1,000 years from now, you probably would get the same reaction. But that doesn't mean that the true nature of man is not exactly to be that creative species in the universe and to be the only species which can conquer these dangers and become the only immortal species on the planet and maybe much beyond. Now, if we are to survive, then only if more and more people think like classical artists and think like natural scientists. And we need to induce that paradigm shift. And we need to have a discussion about that, because what is glaringly absent right now, when you had the Cuba crisis, there was a huge discussion in the media, among the politicians. John F. Kennedy warned that, you know, if it comes to the use of thermonuclear weapons, the people who die in the first minutes will be the happy ones as compared to those who die a few weeks later. Now, there is no such discussion today, even if the danger is much, much bigger. When you had the middle-range missile crisis, the SS-20 Pershing II crisis at the beginning of the 80s, you had hundreds of thousands of people in the street warning that this could lead to the extinction of civilization because these weapon systems were on launch on warning. Now, it is launch on warning practically everywhere, and there is no discussion, despite the fact that everybody can see that we are absolutely close to our own destruction. Now, what we need is not only a discussion about these dangers, because people need to know it and they have to think about it and they have to make an informed decision that they don't want this, but we need to discuss also the alternatives, that there is no reason in the world why we cannot go back to Glass-Steagall, to credit system, to building the real economy, to have scientific breakthroughs, to go back to a culture of humanist classical culture. And we need to have a discussion about that. We cannot just see how civilization is crashing against the wall and not do anything about it. And that is my appeal to you.
If you joined into this broadcast later, what you're watching is a live discussion here with Mrs. Helga Sepp-LaRouche, the president of the Schiller Institute, on the question of the future of humanity. Now, before I get to the questions, yes, you can still send in questions to the email webcast@bueso.de. And we will try to entertain them. And I think that Mrs. LaRouche's remarks have made pretty clear that in order to solve this crisis, and I'm saying this specifically to the youth, to those people who are even much younger than I am, this is not something that we can do in our spare time or on the weekend or as, you know, kind of a side effort to whatever else you may be planning for your personal lives. This is something that we need people to be, and especially young people in Europe, in the United States, and in other parts of the world, to engage in fully, as fully active members or contributors to this organization. Because it is, as you probably can clearly identify from the discussion that we have just heard, this is not something that we can do without our full commitment. So, a number of questions have reached us, and obviously there is always the problem that after such a presentation, you might wish you had written your question just now, in the last minute, because it might have already changed. But these are the times. It is like that. And so I want to get to some of these questions first. I will start with the situation in Europe. We will get to other things a little bit later. But one question, which is somewhat a reasonable one, has reached us from a representative from UNESCO, from Greece. And it says here, no doubt to reestablish the Glass-Steagall Law for banks and use the model of water corridors for a new Marshall Plan for Greece and the Mediterranean, this is important. There's no question about it. But the question is, why is it necessary to abolish the euro for that? And why can we not use the existing monetary union in order to reverse the existing policy and achieve our common goals within that common currency by simply stopping the policy of austerity and misery in Southern Europe?
Well, I think that the euro has a problem because, first of all, Europe was never a so-called optimal currency space, because you would have to have relatively equal or similar conditions in the different countries. Now, one argument which often is made is, well, but the United States also has different degrees of development, and it still functions with the dollar. But the difference is the United States is one country. It has one language. It has one it has one history. It has one culture which binds it together despite differences between the South and the North, the East and the West. But that is not the case for Europe. And while I'm not excluding that sometimes in the distant future we could reach a state of development where a European common currency would make sense, I think that the fact that we do not have a European people, but that we have 27 or maybe more nations in Europe who have a different language, or most of them have a different language, who have a different history, who have a different culture, simply means that, you know, you cannot have a common policy. Because if you, I mean, if you don't have self-participation in the government of the population, then it cannot function. You need to have the representative system where between the governing, the governed and the governed, the governed and the government is a reciprocal legal relationship, which requires people have to know what they're doing. Now, the problem is, I don't think that the people of, for example, the Swiss, French-speaking Swiss, know much about what the Dutch are doing, what the Wallons are doing, what the Bosnians are doing. I'm not reading the newspapers of Italy. I don't know about you know the specific problems of different parts of Spain. But in order to have a common policy, a common currency, you would need to have one language, one people. And the problem is that, you know, I think that there is not a big problem to go back to the national currencies, but you have to have a clear development perspective. And naturally, you want to have a credit system, which means you have to have multinational credit treaties among these sovereign nations, which go over 25, 30, 50 years. And then maybe at the end of that, you come to the conclusion that you want to have a different kind of system. But right now, I think that the only way you can have that kind of development is you need the sovereign control over your currency and your economy. And I don't think that anybody who wants now to have a common Europe, a fiscal union we already almost have, a banking union, or the United States of Europe, I think that at this point, if you ask the people of the different European nations if they want to have a United States of Europe, I'm pretty sure that any referendum, if you would make it, would be absolute no, as it was demonstrated in the case of France and Holland, who did have a referendum in 2005, or as the present trend in Great Britain shows, and especially after the Destroika had imposed these policies on the southern European states. I think the tensions and the almost, you know, hostilities among the countries were never as big as in the post-war period as right now. So the idea to have a common Europe right now, or a unified Europe, which would be the precondition for a European currency, they just don't exist. And if you think about it, you know, let's go back to the national currencies and have this reconstruction. And then it is always our freedom to, in the future, decide what we want to do.
Now, obviously, there are a number of questions dealing with the situation in Greece. And I have to say, unlike at earlier occasions, when we were in discussion with friends and partners in Greece, the description that they give of the problem in Greece is, let's say, it's even clearer than it was before. And so I'm going to try to summarize it a little bit, but you can be sure that Mrs. Sepp-LaRouche will get the question in written form, so we can also discuss it further after this forum. So let's start with one. This comes from a representative in the International Sociological Association and European Sociological Association in Greece. And it says that the Greek authorities have imposed a peculiar embargo on the country's rail links to Europe in 2011. This is something that we also reported and discussed earlier. Our exports to Germany, to Italy, to France have declined during the last 3 years. European multinationals exercise a monopoly control over the national food market, creating a food crisis for children and elderly in Greece. State agencies do not regulate the internal market. It's considered a free market. Transportation infrastructure within the country is inadequate, and development halted since the crisis, making it even more difficult to transport internally the national goods produced in Greece. And since the country is considered the gate from Europe to the East, much of these transport links are not organized. and obviously to the detriment of what's considered a free European economic space. And this is reminiscent of the Victorian era trade between England and India. And as a result of the above named conditions, Greece now exports unprocessed raw materials, which are heavily subsidized by the EU, also reminiscent of the situation in the Soviet Union after the collapse in 1990-1991. We import tents and clothing at the same moment we produce all of Europe's cotton. And in view of the above Greek crisis, Europe has abandoned Greece. The crisis is unevenly imposed upon a small country. And the solution is not to transform them into a special economic zone, as has been clearly described by German and Greek politicians and analysts. Now, this idea of the special economic zone also comes up in a different context, but naming generally the same problem. So this questioner then asks the question, do you think this will make Greece more competitive? Now, I'm not sure if that's really a question or a really ironic statement, but nevertheless, from a different questionnaire, this is raised more clearly, and I'll just add it to that, because they say here, Greece used to have an extensive network, transport network, both sea and air, between the many islands and the mainland, obviously. For over a decade, that has now been privatized, and connections are increasingly expensive, and mainly during the tourist season. Outside the tourist season, often there is no transport available, no matter what price you're willing to pay. It says here, how can we explain to people that you cannot turn essential functions over to the free market without strict governmental standards and regulation, which provides affordable, durable, and reliable connections between the population centers? And simply put, this question is here, what would be your recommendations to the government of Greece?
Well, I think the situation in Greece, you know, in a certain sense, it's just the most dramatic and tragic of all the other situations, but it has nothing to do with Greece. I mean, all this propaganda about, you know, how lazy the Greeks are, how they are not, you know, willing to do this is just complete, utter nonsense. And, you know, the only reason, okay, Greece may have a different culture and philosophy and so forth, but it's you know, not what the media are saying. The reason why Greece has these problems and why these projects have been cut is because especially since the outbreak of the so-called financial crisis in July 2007, there has been only one direction of funds, and that is away from the real economy, away from the living standard of the population, away from the taxpayers of all countries, into the pockets of the banks, the speculators, and you know, the high risk speculation, which has not stopped at all. So in this whole period, what has been accomplished was to transform a crisis of private debt turned into state debt. And now, since the states are overdebted, policies of the EU and the European governments is to compensate that with massive austerity to create balanced budgets. Now, austerity is the most insane and stupid thing you can do. If we should have ever had Chancellor Brüning, we should have learned the lesson that if you impose in the middle of a depression and in the middle of a currency crisis, brutal austerity in the tradition of Brüning and Schacht, you create more unemployment. That was the case from the beginning of the 30s until the taking of power of Adolf Hitler. And it is the case everywhere you do it. So that the increase of unemployment in all of the countries is going up should not be a surprise, because that was very clear And unfortunately, if you look at the ideology of the EU bureaucracy, of these people, Barroso, Rumpoy, and all of these people whose name one actually doesn't even want to remember because, you know, there is a natural impulse not to recognize them as your representative. The ideology of these people is green. Almost all the directives coming from the EU, from Brussels, are green. They are directed against deindustrialization, post-industrial kind of utopias. And, you know, they are only designed to keep a bankrupt banking system afloat, to keep channeling funds into this banking system at the price of hyperinflation, and to squeeze the real economy and the living standard of the population, you know, up to the point of increasing the death rate. And there is no solution within this system. What you have to do is you have to completely abandon the present bankrupt, unsolvable, and unsavable system, cancel it, and go to a credit system. Now, recently, I talked with a representative of a large firm, and I presented these projects to this person, and he said, oh, I know these plans already. These are, in large parts, old EU transport plans, naturally not only, but we have included them. And he said, but who should finance this? And he kept coming back to this one question, who should finance that? Now, it's very simple. The credit system, which we absolutely have to establish if there is supposed to be a solution, is a promise for the productivity of the labor of the future. Now, obviously, if you have a situation in Greece where you have 58% youth unemployment and where 60% or more of all firms and shops are closing down, where young and educated people are leaving the country because they have absolutely no perspective if they stay, then there is no hope. But if you decide to have a plan of economic construction, infrastructure connecting Greece with Asia and with Europe, which it is not by rail right now, and you have other science driver components of such a reconstruction program, you create productive jobs, you attract young people to come back to Greece, to have educated people come back and work there. You give a credit line, but that credit line is a promise for the future because something physical will be produced. And contrary to just pouring money into bankrupt banks, where it leads to hyperinflation and tries to cover the debt of the past, actually useless virtual paper. If you give a credit towards future production and you employ people in productive jobs and you have a meaningful construction program which adds to the wealth of the country, then this future wealth which is being created pays back for the initial credit line. And it can be proven in the history of you know, the last couple of hundred years that everywhere where this policy was applied, the tax revenue after a relatively short time was bigger than the initial credit line, simply because it is the absolute character of human labor to create things which were not there before. It's called the value-added a character of labor. For example, if you say we have a credit line for the next 10, 20, 30 or more years, depending, you know, the time you need to complete a project, and you're not going to try to service these credit lines before the factory is built, before the railroad is built, before the other science centers are built, you just give it as a credit for the duration you need to complete this project, then there is no reason why this does not function. It does not have a hyperinflationary or even inflationary effect, because you are increasing the productivity of the productive facilities and the productivity of labor. And that is simply the model which we have to adopt. And as I said, you know, this was done in the Meiji Restoration in Japan, which turned Japan from totally medieval backward country in a few decades into one of the leading industrial powers of the planet, because Japan was for several centuries completely isolated. And when economists in the middle of the 19th century traveled to Holland, to Germany, to the United States, and they studied Friedrich List and Henry C. Carey, the economic advisor of Lincoln, and they came back to Japan and they implemented these protectionist policies, Japan made this gigantic leap in almost only a couple of decades. The same thing happened when Germany was industrialized with the policies of first Friedrich List, the customs union, but then especially in the period of Bismarck, when through the influence of some industrialists in Germany who studied Henry C. Carey, turned Germany from a free trade country into a protectionist country, Germany became also one of the leading industrial nations of the world. The same thing happened with the Industrial Revolution in Russia, where especially Count Witte played a very important role. It happened with the industrialization of America, with de Gaulle's policies. So there are historical examples where this kind of credit policy or approximations thereof did turn, you know, economic miracles loose. And that is the only way how Greece and Spain and Portugal and other countries ever will come out of this present crisis.
It is indeed a complex problem. And just in case you hear that sound, this is not a complicated Morse code. It's just the heater system. I want to, since the time is limited for these events, I would like to definitely recognize another question, even though it is a little bit too long, that has been sent to us from Greece. This is from a member of the Hellenic Literature Association, a retired military figure, who does, I think, a very thoughtful analysis of various problems in the not only in Greece, but in a larger sphere. He points to huge defense expenditures, to structural problems of the Greek economy that cannot, as he says, or she says, that cannot be solved within the European Union and ECB mechanism of the Troika or Distroika, as we now call it, and points to the situation of Greece also geographically, which is not comparable to other countries of Europe, because this is Greece is situated at the joining point of three continents, so it has a special role. And it says here, Greece must remain economically and politically stable, because as a stabilizer and peacekeeper in the area, since that is that function of Greece is lacking, it has also destabilized a very volatile situation in the Balkans and the Eastern Mediterranean. So to the author, I will pass this question on for a bit more of a detailed treatment, because it's just a little bit too long. I wanted to recognize it, though, because a friend from Turkey, a longtime friend of our organization, has sent in a very simple question that touches upon what you are raising. And it says here, Turkey started a new foreign policy under the slogan "Zero Problems Abroad" a couple of years ago, and now she ended up surrounded with enemies. The question is, what did the foreign affairs minister of Ankara do wrong, or what was wrong in his ways of thought?
Well, I think that the situation for both Greece and Turkey is essentially that the problem is empire. That you have homemade problems for sure, and you know, I think in Turkey you have different historical you know, currents and tendencies which are quite opposite to each other. But I would say that the large part is really not located either in Greece nor in Turkey, but that the problem is right now that you have a tendency to towards empire. And that tendency existed, obviously, for a long time, but it really escalated when the Soviet Union disintegrated, because the natural impulse to keep a certain amount of science and technological progress, in part also motivated by the fact that you had two armies of two blocs, that you had a certain counterbalance, you know, you had, which was not a good thing, but it you know, had a certain effect that you had countries allied with either the West and the United States and Europe, or with Russia or with China, created a different dynamic, which, you know, led to, as I said, it was not a desirable condition, but it left certain options. And what is happening since the collapse of the Soviet Union, you had this drive to what is normally called globalization, which really was a huge paradigm shift in the direction of, you know, basically increase the power of the banking sector, of speculation, away from production, outsourcing production to slave labor markets, to have an increased integration of the banking system, of the central banks, the investment banks, the hedge funds, the security firms, becoming this financial monster called globalization, which we call the British Empire, because it is the policy of empire. And a lot of things can only be explained as a derivative of this larger empire tendency in the world. Because a derivative of that policy is then that certain interests were financed. For example, the spread of these NGOs, the spread of organizations which pretend to be advocates of democracy and human rights, but in reality, in many cases, turned out to be destabilizing forces for the sake of the empire, for the sake of regime change, as we could see it in the case of the Orange Revolution in Ukraine, the Rose Revolution in Georgia, or now this disgusting spectacle of Pussy Riot in Russia, where one can only say, you know, that the people who are promoting these kinds of values, they should really look into the mirror of what are they promoting. Now, as I said, the tendencies of this, I would really urge you to consider, because the dynamic, why are all the neighbors of Turkey now in an adversary condition? I don't know if that is really the result of Turkish policy, or is it not the result of a general dynamic which has turned the whole world into a nightmare of the kind I was speaking of in the beginning. And in the same way, I think only if we return to the paradigm of the Peace of Westphalia, where national sovereignty is being respected, where we form a community of principle among sovereign nation states, and part of the new paradigm has to be you know, that the interest of the other, which is one of the crucial principles of the Peace of Westphalia, has to be put on the table. We are on the verge of our own destruction by pursuing supposed geopolitical interests against each other, or for the sake of this empire. And we have to replace this by a system which was accomplished after long, 4-year-long discussion in Münster, establishing the Peace of Westphalia, where the first principle was that for the sake of peace, that all crimes committed by either one side or the other have to be put aside and forgotten. And the second very important principle was that for the sake of peace, from now on, every country has to pursue it, the interest of the other as if it would be its own interest. Now, I happen to think that this approach comes from Nicolaus of Cusa, the great thinker of the 15th century, who was the father of the sovereign nation state, outlined for the first time in his one of his early works, Concordantia Catholica, and which has the idea that peace in the macrocosm can only exist if you allow the development of all microcosms, and meaning nations, and that each microcosm, each nation, has to absolutely develop the other nation to its own self-interest. And I think that that principle, which is obviously the opposite of present foreign policy, which is subversion, murder, destabilization, if we cannot come to this level of understanding, then the consequences will be such as I outlined earlier. But I believe in the ingenuity of people. I believe that man is capable of making a leap, and that Gottfried Leibniz was absolutely correct when he said that a great evil has the power to evoke an even greater good. And that is what we have to do. And that is why I'm saying we need to have a discussion about the peace initiatives. And I'm re-emphasizing it because obviously these questions were sent before what I laid out in my presentation. But the answer is in what I said. We have to have a paradigm shift. We have to have a comprehensive, large development project for the entire region from Central Asia to the Gulf, from Iran to the Mediterranean as one region. And I have a vision how that can look in 20, 30 years from now as an incentive for people to stop killing each other. And we have to have an agreement on the common aims of mankind, fighting together against the threats which could kill us all, which range from nuclear missiles to asteroids, earthquakes and green policy, and we have to defeat those things, and that is what we need to discuss. And I would actually urge people beyond this webcast to keep calling us, sending emails, sending contributions, write in papers, because we want to open an international forum for the discussion of such constructive solutions as an alternative to the present doomsday policy of the EU and other governments.
Well, I would like to turn to a subject that is in this situation pretty obvious that it would have come up, which is the US presidential election or the re-election of President Obama. Now, in one shorter email, which I think it's probably more a side aspect specific to the situation in Germany, the questioner refers to the problem that the German people apparently have, but the United States population might have as well, since they re-elected President Obama, the difficulty of actually recognizing what kind of policy this president stands for. But I would like to get to a, in that context, to a longer question that was also sent before, not only this webcast, but also before the election, but which points, I think which opens for an important aspect here. So it says here, and I'm going to have to read a part of this just to make it clear. It says here, the media are concentrating very much on Europe and the euro crisis. Now with the coming election of the United States, a political situation could evolve with much graver effects than even the euro crisis. So in that context, I would like to ask, how long can a President Obama, under the current conditions in the Congress and in the Senate, how long can he even remain in office? For months now, we have the impression that political America has come to a standstill and is in a catch-22. With Obama and a renewed period in office for him, no political solution seems in sight, and no solution to the economic problems. Also, I don't expect anything from the central bank, which has now added QE, quantitative easing, to the so-called conventional means, which seems completely without effect. But the Republicans putting up Mitt Romney, who seems to have no, it was a frightening option here, because he seems helpless. He does not, anyway, I can shorten that. Romney for now is out of the picture. But anyway, the questioner says, it really makes you think, why did the Republicans not commit to a more able candidate or a more capable candidate? And the question then ends, should Obama be reelected and forced to step down or be impeached within the next 2 years? What would a political solution for the United States look like for the five coming years? Was Mitt Romney only a tactical candidate of the Republicans in their calculation of a big political big bang to then put up a more durable candidate and put the Democratic Party into the off in the long term? So, yeah.
Well, I think the situation in the United States is serious but not hopeless, because as I tried to say in the beginning, this circumstances of the resignation of General Petraeus, the Benghazi gate, September 11th, number two, if there is a serious effort now to investigate all of this, and I think that it cannot be put back into the genie cannot be put back into the bottle. You have the chance to unearth all which went wrong in American foreign policy. Now, I don't know if that will happen or not, but there is the potential to do so. There are patriots in the Congress, in the Senate, and in other institutions. I had the fortune to talk to some of them or see some of them in action. I know that there is a gigantic effort right now to impose Glass-Steagall. right now, for example, it's very difficult for me to judge how quickly this Benghazi gate investigation will lead to a possible impeachment of Obama, but it could very quickly do that. There is the additional problem of the so-called financial cliff, that the 8-people commission, which were supposed to cut the budget by 1.2 trillion, failed to reach a compromise, and therefore the so-called sequestration is now coming into play, which is the automatic cut of 600 billion in the defense sector and 600 billion in the social security area, which is absolutely unbelievable because it will cut into life important questions in the social field, and it will cut in a lot of jobs in the defense sector. So there is a big upheaval about that, and all of this, you know, is really making clear the United States is bankrupt, their foreign policy has failed, and I can only hope that all of this will increase the drive for Glass-Steagall. There is right now a good potential in the Senate that the Senate will introduce a similar bill for Glass-Steagall like it exists in the Congress with the bill of Marcy Kaptur, because in the recent Senate election, two new candidates were elected to become senator who are very known proponents for Glass-Steagall. So if there would be an introduction of a Glass-Steagall legislation in the Senate, and there is a growing motion by such people as Thomas Hoening, who is the vice chairman of the FDIC for Glass-Steagall, and others, there are regional banking associations, representatives of savings banks. So I think that if this motion towards Glass-Steagall could be implemented in November or December, in the period before, you know, the next period of the president takes place, I think the sequestration goes into effect on the 3rd of January. So if Glass-Steagall would be implemented before, and you would have a move towards a credit system, then a positive solution is possible. Now, if that doesn't happen, all hell will break loose. So we are really in a very short-term mobilization for, you know, trying to get an alternative. And, you know, we, our organization, can take the credit of having created a debate for Glass-Steagall in Europe. If you would have asked 2 years ago people, what is Trendbankensystem, what is Glass-Steagall, they would have said, no idea. In the meantime, you have all kinds of Trendbanken discussions, the so-called Lee Cannon, which is not it. You have even Steinbrück coming out for Trendbanken, which turns out, if you look at it closer, to be just the old Vickers Commission and ring fencing, a proposal which has been dismissed already as non-functioning by parts of the City of London and even representatives of Wall Street. You have a lot of economists in France, in Switzerland, in Italy, talking about Glass-Steagall. You have a bill in the Icelandic parliament, which has a very good chance of being adopted by the entire Icelandic parliament at the beginning of next year. You have similar initiatives all over the place. And if the United States would implement Glass-Steagall, then that's the first step to getting out of this mess. So please contact us, join our efforts to put pressure on the parliaments to not miss this opportunity, because the absolute only chance is now. Between November, December, we need to have a change, or else everything will spin out of control. So please contact us and help us to you know, implement that.
I would like at this point to recognize a question that has come in, but I think during Mrs. Zeplarouche's remarks has been answered several times. Nevertheless, it is important because I think it's a question that many people have in mind, a question from a senior African diplomat who says the following, as has been witnessed during the last meeting of the G20, one would wonder if there is no money to bail out everybody, or if there is no money to bail out the poor. We observe that there is a large amount of money earmarked for defaulted banks in the United States and in Europe, but not even $1 billion is earmarked to the poor countries, which they need to keep their growth momentum so that they will also play their part to curb the economic crisis of the world. Why? As I said, I think this question has been addressed very much, and I'm just for time reason, if you want to say something about it, but for time reason, I would like also to take on one other subject which came in, and it's often to be expected, which deals with the situation in Russia and also the relation of Russian policy to other countries. One question which we often run into is our lack of, or our apparent lack of criticism of the Russian president, Putin. Why are we not criticizing Putin? But I think on a more serious note, what is the role and you've addressed it in part, what is the role of Russia in the conflict in Syria? Because obviously there are many things that are being criticized, maybe justly, maybe not, in the internal situation in Russia with regards to human rights and the freedom of the press and so forth. But obviously the relation of such a large nuclear-armed country in a conflict that could become a nuclear war, as they have warned, namely in Syria, I think is much more important. So maybe you can go again a little bit into the question of the role of Russia in today's strategic situation.
Well, I still would like to briefly answer the gentleman from Africa, because, I mean, you know, if you look at the development of the last 40 years, it is very clear that since the paradigm towards the green paradigm, which started really at the end of the 60s with the emergence of the Club of Rome, there was the clear intention that the Third World should be reduced in terms of their population. And all the policies do not make any sense if you don't take that as the premise and the intention. In the 50s and in the 60s, you had in the United Nations the idea of development decades, which was the idea that in every decade you would have certain goals of development, overcoming poverty, improving the social structure, improving the living standard, having longer life expectancy, and to progress and progress decade after decade to eventually overcome underdevelopment. That was in the 50s and the 60s a self-evident policy. And then when basically the oligarchy decided that, you know, there should be a paradigm shift, then the idea of underdevelopment was replaced with the notion of overpopulation. Now, overpopulation at the beginning of the 70s was known among all the left groups and NGOs to be a Rockefeller baby. With other words, being an interest campaign by certain multinational interests. But people knew that if you have real development, you know, women at a certain point do not want to have 10 or 14 children, but they want to have their own studies. They want to, you know, learn enough so that they would have an average of children, two children or one child or three children or four at most. But they wouldn't like to have you know, so many children as they are now forced to have some pension perspective and they're old. So the idea basically to reduce the population was a conscious paradigm shift induced at the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s. And this policy is mass murder. Because, you know, you look at what the Pope said, Pope John Paul II, when the communist system collapsed between 89 and 91. He caused a big uproar by saying that those people who say that capitalism has proven morally superior to communism are completely wrong, and that one system is as evil as the other, and that if you needed a proof, you just had to look at the condition of the Third World to see the evidence of that. I remember that that caused a huge freak out at the time, but the Pope was absolutely correct. And now you have a policy which is conscious mass murder, conscious reduction of population, increasing the death rate, decreasing the birth rate. And unless this is blasted and the people who propagate these things, like Prince Philip or the World Wildlife Fund, which prevents the building of important infrastructure like dams and other things, deliberately causing people to die, these things must be condemned, and there needs to be, now I don't remember this word, there needs to be an Ächtung of these policies. So I just want to say that And people have to basically, you know, network so that, you know, the idea about real development plans becomes more known. And hopefully, when this present crisis really erupts and the system is changing, which it either does or we go up in war, then there is the possibility to also put a real development perspective for Africa and other places on the agenda. Now, concerning Russia, well, it's very simple. I think that President Putin is probably the single reason and the single man why World War III has not yet started, maybe together with General Dempsey and my husband and a couple of few others. But if Putin would not have put his foot down, so to speak, to defend the UN Charter, to defend the idea of the sovereignty of nations, as he has done in the case of Syria, then this motion to roll over and have regime change after regime change probably would have already gone further and wiped out Iran and, you know, I mean, the effort to destabilize Russia through the same apparatus of George Soros, which was behind the Orange Revolution in Georgia and the Rose Revolution in Ukraine and the Rose Revolution in Georgia, is already, you know, in motion against Russia. The so-called White Revolution or the so-called Arab Spring in Russia is the same idea. And similar destabilizations have been tried against China, but with very little success. So, you know, I think that the question of human rights and democracy is a very relative thing. I think if you look at the conditions in Greece, how they're cutting the pension of old people, how they are shortening their life by denying medical care, don't you think that that is a human rights violation? Where is democracy in Europe? Who has been asked if they want to have the euro? Who has been asked if we want to have a European president? I don't recall that I ever voted for either the euro or a European president. So there is no democracy worth talking about fundamental questions like what kind of a constitution do we want? Do we want to give our sovereignty away to a supranational bureaucracy which is not accountable? Anyway, I think people should be a little bit more thoughtful about these notions about democracy, human rights. And I think that while the Russian policy is not perfect by no means, I think the influence of neoliberal financial policies is still much too strong. I think there is not a clear understanding about what a credit policy is. There is not enough emphasis on retransforming Russia back again to an industrial power after the Yeltsin period turned it into a raw material producer. So there are many criticisms, but I think that the general policy of Russia is one to protect national sovereignty, and in that way they have contributed probably the most to prevent World War III from happening. And that is the most important matter. Other questions we should discuss, but if you compare the big projects which are on the agenda in Russia and the complete lack of any such projects in the EU, I think even on that account, Russia looks much, much better than any country affected by this destroyer.
You mentioned earlier Steinbrück and his proposal there, which is already outdated. Now, since there will be a federal election in Germany next year, and from what it looks like now, which doesn't say much, but I'm just saying from what it looks like now, it might be an equally, you know, bleak choice there when it comes to credible politicians and credible statesmen, I would like to ask the following question, which came from a member of BÜSO in Germany. And it says, on October 1st, Peer Steinbrück was nominated as the candidate for chancellor for the SPD. Since that time, accusations about his supplementary incomes and unpublished speaking fees are coming in almost daily. And as we know, the timing when these so-called skeletons are taken out of the closet is rarely coincidental. It's usually not an accident. I would like to ask the following questions. Are the obvious attempts of the CDU and FDP to get rid of Steinbrück, are these part of a common party struggle, or are we dealing with factors which aim beyond whatever election results we'll see in 2013?
Well, I think as the aftermath of the Steinbrück fee scandal made very clear, that whoever sits in the glass house should not throw with stones, because now it turns out that the so-called coalition parties were also quite liberal in filling their pockets with such fees. I mean, I think that the question for me is, why was the city of Bochum so stupid to pay 25,000 euro for a speech which you know, doesn't really contribute anything to the solutions of the existential problems? So, you know, I think it's just totally stupid to do this. And unfortunately, you know, when Mr. Steinbrück, who otherwise wanted to charge the cavalry against Switzerland, which has contributed to the present image problems Germany has in that country, his proposal for a Trennbankensystem is really, unfortunately, you know, in the frame of Vickers Commission, Volcker Rule, and therefore it's not the real thing. And one could also not expect that somebody who is so much on the side of the banking system and has been invited by banks and similar interests to take care of the you know, poorer parts of the population. I think that the SPD is suffering from the result of this now by dramatically dropping numbers in the polls. And I just think this whole thing makes clear that in reality, we would need in Germany the same thing what my husband has proposed for the United States, namely that the party system does not function. Now, I'm saying that consciously, despite the fact that I'm the chairwoman of a party, but nevertheless, I mean, I think the European parliamentarian party system is much worse than the presidential system in the United States. Because in the United States, you have at least the primary system where candidates run for the voters' approval in the primaries, and they have to be tested with the voters. So the voter has at least a little ability to, you know, imprint his wishes in the outcome of such an election. In Germany, it is the Fraktionszwang, the party discipline, which totally controls who becomes a candidate or, you know, what is the thinking of the candidate. In reality, this is anti-constitutional because Article 38 of the Grundgesetz says the representative is only responsible to his own conscience and not anything else. But in practice, nobody would ever say anything which is not approved by the party leadership, because then they would be afraid that they would not be put up for the next election. So in reality, when people in Germany say there's nothing you can do, there is a big problem with that, because actually it's very little. And then if you have such anarchic formations like the Pirate Party, that's a very short-lived affair, because then the lack of any substance, lack of any program means that such parties also collapse then very quickly. Now, therefore, you know, I think we really would also need a different discussion, or we need a discussion in Germany, because there is none. There is no discourse. There is no discussion about war or peace. There is no discussion about economic method. It's all streamlined in the parties, in the media. We have a total thought control in this country. And that is why, one of the reasons why we are making these webcasts and we are inviting you to enter a dialogue is because we have to revive the discussion culture in this country. And eventually, you know, we have to have representatives who are representing the true interests of Germany and not those people who have the big money and purses to direct how the discussion goes, which is the case for the media, which is the case for the parties. And that is the reason why, despite this financial crisis is already more than 5 years raving and raging, there has been not one re-regulation, because these parties completely obey the sources where they are being financed from. And that is a proven fact, because if it would be otherwise, we would not have this mess. So we need a change in the culture, and we need to have an open discussion about policies. And eventually, we should think if the parties of the parliamentarian system are really the best way to organize ourselves, or if we should not really have the representatives from the different avant-garde fields, from science, from labor, from art, and have people representing real skills rather than these politicians.
So we will come to the end. Mrs. Zeppler-Rouge's time is valuable, and I would like to recognize that also she does have other engagements. So I will take the liberty to try to compose the last question out of three, simply because these they go in a very similar direction, or the answer to one of these also answers the others. One questioner greets the participants of the webcast from Spain and raises, I think, an interesting question and a fair one today by simply saying it is very difficult to organize for the ideas that the Schiller Institute represents, because people have lost to a large degree their faith in politicians, and they are afraid that this organization will end up just like all the others. So the question here is, what is the difference between all the political groups of today and the Schiller Institute? And the other two, well, one comes from someone I know is very much concerned with recruiting young people to be active and actively engaged in this organization, and simply asks to say a word or two about what the future youth culture should look like, because the problems in today's youth culture are obvious. And Helga, you already addressed the common aims of mankind, but what specifically would be the role of youth today to get that new outlook shaped and actually created? And in that context, I think the third question fits right in. What is the best way to be sure and rigorous when it comes to a conception of universal truth versus only experienced facts? And yeah, I would just give you that as a last question.
Well, I think that what's different about the Schiller Institute and other organizations, well, obviously, the fact that we have been around for more than, not as Schiller Institute, but as La Rouge organization, more than 40 years, and we have not been corrupted. Now, the negative side of that is we don't have big money bags, we don't have hedge funds who are filling our banking accounts, But we still exist, and that despite enormous efforts to stop us. And I have been asked many times, why is it that you are still doing these things, you know? I mean, wouldn't it be easier to just adapt to the mainstream, to the current trends? And I think that, you know, once you have really an understanding about what it takes to understand the real laws of the universe, how you have to apply scientific criteria, those things which normally are only done by physicists, chemists, biologists, geophysicists or other scientists, and you take that as the way to think, and that you take the and you are trying to understand and master the composition of Bach, of Beethoven, of Schubert, Schumann, of great poets like Schiller, Shakespeare, and you are trying to understand what was the creativity which went into their discoveries. And then you try to have that kind of a method of thinking in all other areas of life, in politics, in your private life, in your social life. In other words, that I agree with Friedrich Schiller, who in the aesthetical letters, in the letters for the aesthetical education of men, which he wrote after the collapse of the French Revolution into the Jacobin terror, he basically said that the future of mankind would really only be possible or, you know, functioning if people would think like scientists and great artists. And these are the only people who believe that there are knowable physical or artistic principles. And that is a way how you can train your mind, and that is the key to creativity. Now, I think that the key difference between this organization and other organizations is, you know, we don't have certain, you know, interest for this or that, but we have an interest about to increase the creativity of mankind in the universe and to contribute with our life and our efforts, our share, so that mankind can overcome this present, what I call infantilism or juvenile delinquency, and reach the age of adulthood. You know, in that sense, we are selfless in thinking like Socrates or thinking like Solon of Athens, who, according to Friedrich Schiller, when he was asked what is the purpose of mankind, he said progression, that man progresses. And that is right now in big jeopardy. So I think, you know, in a certain sense, what makes us different, and I'm saying this in all with a humble attitude, what makes us different is that we have love for mankind, that we have passion, that we cannot see this present condition of Africa, of the youth culture, of all of these terrible conditions which are in violation of the dignity of man. And once you have reached that standpoint and you are not a complete, you know, temporary, you know, some people for a certain point find these ideas interesting, but then they want to have their petty bourgeois concerns. But once you really have tasted the sweetness of truth, as Nicolaus of Cus called it once, then you don't want other foods, you know, you're not interested in all these pleasures which normal organizations are corruptible by. And that makes us different. And the fact that we still exist after more than 40 years sticking to our guns, well, I think there are a lot of people who show respect that we do that. And they also show respect that we are a developing organization, that we pursue creativity, that we have as a standard that all of our members should continuously develop and not become Brotgelehrte at a certain point, but, you know, that there is a continuous exploring of new items, of new subjects, of new discoveries. And that's the way how people should live. So, you know, we are in that sense actually a very happy organization. And, you know, I think that what youth should do, I mean, if youth understand where we are at, that with the present system, they have absolutely no future. I mean, we all may have no future, but even if World War III would not occur in the near future, you know, if you are a young person, what you hear is for the first time that the older people say, yeah, my children and my grandchildren will have a worse life than I. This is the first time in history that this happened. It used to be the opposite. It used to be that parents would say, you know, I'm working so that my children and my grandchildren will have it better than me. And right now, you know, that is sort of, that road is blocked. And, you know, if you have a large percentage of youth unemployment, you have no future. So I think that if the youth or those among you who really understand that, and that you would make a commitment and say, I reject the youth culture, I reject everything which has to do with disco, pop music, and I will try to study what is classical music. I will discover the principles of classical composition, and I will make sure that future great composers will emerge, and maybe I'm one of them. So that basically in the areas of art, of science, reject the mainstream. The mainstream is really mediocre, it's going downhill, it has led to this present crisis. And, you know, I think that if young people would really discover the pearls of the Greek classical culture, which after all, you know, is the cradle of European civilization. And by the way, I believe that there is a motion in Greece right now among certain exceptional people, intellectuals, to revive the great tradition of ancient Greek, to revive the writings of Plato, of Socrates, to revive the great tragedies of the great tragedians, Aeschylus and others, and to simply, you know, put back the cultural greatness of Greece on the agenda and make that the foundation for future developments. And the same thing goes for Spain, for Portugal, who after all had also their Renaissance periods, as well as Italy. And I think if young people would just say, you know, this present globalization system has cheated us, it does not give us a future, but we have found the fountain where to find the you know, the pearls and the treasures to create a future, then, you know, I think it can be done. It just needs to be informed and it needs to be programmatic, and that is then really the way to solve this. So I think young people have a tremendous opportunity right now, because more and more people will recognize in the immediate future that we definitely need a huge change, a paradigm which will overturn everything, because this thing cannot continue the way it is. Mankind is in an existential crisis, and I think that that is also potentially the beginning of a new era of mankind, which leaves behind us all these things which we are contemplating as bad today.
Holger, thank you very much. We're just concluding a live webcast with Mrs. Helga Zeppler-Rusch. And I think in conclusion, I have if you could weigh this is enough homework to, you know, start right away and have long days and short nights. Because it really, I think this webcast shows exactly what we addressed now in the end, or what you addressed in the end. What makes this movement different from every other one? So my feeling tells me that we should turn these webcast proceedings into a DVD to make it available for download on the Schiller Institute and related websites, and also available for order as a physical copy, because this is an excellent tool to organize. And to organize, for instance, to make more such events possible, but also As you can imagine, some of you might have participated in earlier events of this kind to make more of these, to actually bring people together for these kinds of discussions and bring these policies to the nations of the world that need it so direly right now. So in closing, I would ask you, if you're not already doing so regularly, to contribute to this movement generously. And if you haven't entertained that thought before, to join us in this struggle. Since after, I think, yeah, maybe you just go through your notes and really think about what has been discussed this afternoon and take it to heart and act accordingly. I hope that we can announce a new webcast very soon. You will see that on the websites as soon as we can make up a date, because these forums are, I think, essential at this current juncture in history. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much, Helga, for being here. And I hope to see you all very soon. Good night.